Good morning. This is the Salvation Army in Bedlington, and we welcome you to our online worship. This morning, we're going to be talking about the call of God, and Major Cheryl has a message out of Exodus on the call of Moses. I want to encourage you to grab that cup of coffee or tea and sit back and enjoy the worship along with us this morning. I also want to let you know to be on the lookout for information regarding our reopening. We're going to reopen on September 6th and have a meeting here on the building. It's going to be limited, of course, by all the COVID-19 restrictions, but we're going to give it a go and open up here on the building. And so please be prayerful for that as we prepare for that. And be watching for information on Facebook and your email. We'll be getting information out regarding that in the days to come. So again, enjoy the worship this morning. Thank you.
Good morning and welcome to our home. As part of our worship today, we invite you to join our time of prayer. As we think about the scripture today, which is taken from Exodus chapter 3, this is Moses' encounter with God at the burning bush, where God says to Moses, "Stop, take off your shoes, for you are standing on holy ground." I am sure we all experience our holy ground moments, which we accept or decline what God is revealing to us. Then we pray, we wait, we talk about them, But then we have to move. We have to step out. Today, whatever your need may be, whether you need encouragement, peace, strength, or rest, God can meet you in a very real and present way. And the place where you sit or stand just now can become holy ground. Let's come before him with humble hearts and pray. Dear God, thank you for your amazing power and work in our lives. Thank you for your goodness and for your blessings over us. Thank you for your great love and care. Thank you for your sacrifice so that we might have freedom and life. Forgive us when we don't thank you enough for who you are, for all that you do for us, and for all that you've given. Help us to set our eyes and our hearts on you afresh. Renew our spirits. Fill us with your peace and joy. We love you and we need you this day and every day. We give you praise and thanks. For you alone are worthy.
And Lord, as we look to the future, and as we begin in the coming weeks to prepare to be able to meet together for worship and prayer in our own Salvation Army Hall, we thank you for those who are working behind the scenes to ensure that our building is prepared and that plans are in place to enable us to gather together safely in the very different circumstances and under the often very difficult constraints that we find ourselves in during these days. And Lord, as during the coming months, we as your Salvation Army family here in Bedlington begin to embrace the challenges and to explore the options and to envision the opportunities that you set before us in this year of 2020. We pray that our vision may be venturesome, that our feet may be faithful and fearless in following wherever you lead, that our hearts may be filled with hope, and that our lives may exude your love as we fully experience your love for us and as we fully express our love for one another. And in the words of Salvation Army Songbook 689, when we cannot see our way, let us trust and still obey. He who bids us forward go cannot fail the way to show. Be it ours then while we're here, him to follow without fear. Where he calls us, there to go. What he tells us, that to do.
Thank you.
scripture reading is from Exodus chapter 3 and verses 1 through 12, and I'll be reading from the New International Version. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the far side of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God said to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, Here I am. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go, I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you, and this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain.
Today, we are looking at Exodus 3, 1 through 12. It is the first episode in the narrative of Moses' call by God to be the deliverer of Israel. The entire narrative runs to 4:17.
In a nutshell, God calls and Moses objects several times for various reasons. God is persistent in his call, and finally Moses submits. Wise move. Moses is in the wilderness tending the sheep of his father-in-law, going about his own business. Suddenly, God encounters him by means of a burning bush that is not consumed by the flames. Notice that Moses was not looking for God, but God was looking for Moses. I suspect that God is and has been looking for us long before we think to look for God. As God calls and Moses approaches the bush, God warns Moses not to come any closer, but to take off his shoes, for he is standing on holy ground. Why does holy ground require bare feet? To be honest, I don't know. But think about this. Who makes shoes? Humans do. Who makes feet? God does. God is unapproachable through human manufactured stuff, be the stuff high tech or simply a pair of sandals. Human-made stuff is too pretentious for God. To enter into God's holy presence requires the removal of all pretension. Only God-made stuff can enter into God's holy presence. Moses can only stand on holy ground in his bare feet as one made in the image of God. God's message to Moses centers on three key words that work out throughout the book of Exodus: see, hear, and know. These three words come to summarize the Israelite understanding of God. I have seen the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry on account of their taskmasters, and indeed, I know their sufferings. God is the one who sees the circumstances of our lives, the one who hears our cries and groaning in prayer, and who knows us well enough to come into our lives and brings his enabling presence to address our needs. In this case, it is a declaration of deliverance, of salvation. Yet it is not only deliverance from oppression, but a promise of the blessings of a land flowing with milk and honey. We should not always expect physical reward for serving God or immediate solutions to our problems when we cry out in times of distress. That reduces God to a dispenser of treats. It was no magic solution for the Israelites. There would be many years of struggle ahead down a sometimes dark and rough road. Yet the journey began with their cries to a seeing, hearing, and knowing God. The nature of this God, the one who sees and hears and knows, tells us that we can expect things to happen in our lives when we turn to this God. God calls Moses to be his agent of this impending deliverance. Moses has tried to be the deliverer once before and had failed. We find that in Exodus 2, 11 through 15. He had grown up in Pharaoh's household, and the Israelites were not willing to accept him as the leader of a rebellion against the might of Egypt. But now God tells Moses, I have picked you to lead my people out of Egypt. Like most of us would do when confronted with such an impossible task, Moses immediately questions his credentials for such a task, pointing out to God by his question his lack of ability. Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? No doubt that earlier failure and rejection weighs heavily on Moses as he hears the commission from God. Subtly, Moses shifts the responsibility for the success or failure of the task to himself. In effect, he has just condemned the entire project to failure by placing the outcome on himself. Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh? The answer, of course, is you are no one. And Moses is right. This is the first of a series of five objections, reasons why Moses cannot possibly succeed. On one level, these objections are psychological, the fear and misgivings of one who has already tried and failed. On another level, they are theological, expressing the all too true reality that Moses, on his own cannot challenge Pharaoh. Too often, the challenges of life are beyond our own personal abilities. But then, that's really the point. Moses doesn't have to succeed on his own. Who am I that I should do this? Is a fair question. Is Moses capable? He hasn't been in the past. Will the people follow him? They refused before. And there's a subtle unspoken question that begins to play out in the story. Is Pharaoh thought by Egyptians to be the incarnation of the Egyptian god Ra, more powerful than the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? That begins to emerge as the real issue of the narrative. In response, God shifts the focus from Moses and his inability to God and his sufficiency. I am and will be with you. That is what matters. That is what qualifies. That is what makes one equal to a God-given task. I am and will be with you. God has a habit of calling us in over our heads, calling us beyond our qualifications, asking us to do something beyond ourselves, or so we think. We frequently respond as Moses did, "Who am I for such an assignment? I'm not qualified." God does not try to convince us that we are qualified. Instead, God offers the promise, "I am and will be with you." Whatever God is calling you to, no matter how over your head it might be, trust his promise to be present. It is God's presence and only God's presence that enables us to do God's bidding. At the close of Matthew, where Jesus commissions his disciples to go and make disciples, what does Jesus promise them? "I will be with you always." In 2 Corinthians 2:14 through 3:6, Paul raises the question as to who is adequate for such a task of being a minister of the gospel. Paul's answer No one except whom God has made competent through Christ. The presence of Christ and nothing but makes one adequate for the ministry of Christ. As God calls you into his ministry, don't get stuck on your own inadequacies. Hear the promise, I am and will be with you. Some hurting folks are counting on you believing that promise. Hear it again, I am and will be with you. Don't focus on yourself, but focus on the one calling you. I am and will be with you. Answer the call. Remember that God is with us in all we do, and he could be calling you. Make sure that you're listening to God today.